Sausage! Oh, fuck! Uhuru! Shoutouts to Ryan Katsu Yamagashi! It's the first live show. Hello, everybody! Shoutouts! Live from Chicago, it's our first show on Cumia! He is our king. Bow to the king. This part of the song is where it gets a little embarrassing for me. So we do need a remix of that. I was talking about that on show 00. I was saying we definitely need some. For those of you who know what that was, that's the old Opie and Anthony music. So I wanted to get people hype, but we definitely need a new remix version. And I think I might have one today. We have a listener email from somebody who sent in one, so we're going to take a listen to that. Guys, this is amazing to be here. We have a live show. We've got a live chat. I want to welcome people into the chat first. Redbarradio.net/chat. Now, there are a couple of chat rules. So before you start typing like animals, I'm going to give you the chat rules, and they're pretty simple. But first, we've got a party, okay? This is a lot of pressure here for me, okay? First time live, King Cumia, Compound Media, big fan of Cumia for a long time. So being on the network here, it's, these things could be a lot of pressure. So we are going to be drinking. I've got today, I hope you could drink with me. We could do whatever we want today. We really can't. Friday, nobody's on after us. So I'm hoping tonight we drink, we smoke, and we do whatever we want. So I've got Cumia's favorite beverage here, Coca-Cola Classic. You've seen him drinking these on recent shows. Nothing finer than a nice cold Coke. So we'll have some of these. We'll have some of these. Drink with me, guys. It's very exciting to be here, okay? Let's kick this one off. Here we go. Oh! Finally. I've really been looking at that one all day, waiting to have it. So, yeah, let's get in the chat. Redbarradio.net/chat. A big part of our live show is the chat here. So, redbarradio.net/chat. And I want to give you the chat rules. Somebody in the chat already asking, are you wearing knee-high boots? Yes. Yeah, why? It's fall. So, we've got the chat. And then I was thinking, you know, all these new shows, what they do is they start explaining their show and they go, on this show, we're going to do this. But I thought that's too faggoty to do. And I can't imagine myself going, you know, especially because we've been doing this show for a long time. I can't imagine starting over and explaining the show and coming on here and going, hey, you know, so we're going to cover all the hottest topics of the day. And, you know, it gets a little crazy around here, you know, so I don't think we should do any of that. I think episode 00, yeah, by the way, if you haven't seen any of this yet, go back to episode 00. It's on compoundmedia.com right now. And check that out. I kind of explained it a little, but I figured let's just pretend it's a normal show. I was talking to Sven and we were, you'll meet Sven very soon. We were going, we should do something big for the first show. We should really pull out all the stops and make it big. And then I said, but that's not what we do on the show. So then it would be like all these new people are here to see this first show. And then I've got to have all this stuff set up that's making me nervous and worrying if it works. And we don't even do that kind of stuff on the show. So I figured, let's just keep it like it always is. Don't change anything. And then once everybody gets to know us, then we could do all the crazy big stuff. But it's awesome to be here. This is going to be a very, very, very fun day. Yeah, explanations are something the meat man does. Tough commute from Chicago. Yes, this show is broadcasting live out of our studio here in Chicago, which needs a little bit of a remodel, to be honest. You know, I don't want you guys to think I think this is cool. You know, this is something that was, you know, thrown together over years and years of podcasting. So I think this year, you know, depending on how this all goes, it should go pretty good. We should be redoing the set here, redoing the cameras. You'll have some more angles and all that stuff. So, chat rules. I wanted to clear this up right away because a lot of people, they see a chat and all of a sudden they think it's a free-for-all. But our chat is a little bit different. Rule number one, there is to be no talking shit about me whatsoever. I hate to start the show on such a serious note, but yeah, this show is supposed to be fun for me, first and foremost. So I don't want to come into the chat and see, oh, this guy's, you know, I saw a guy earlier. Oh, this guy's man cow. I'm not man cow. Okay, we're going to prove that today. What, because my voice? Are you making fun of my voice? Yeah, people don't make fun of me around here. We do the making fun of around here. So I wanted to reach out to all the new people today and say, before you start thinking, oh, I got something to say about this guy, remember where you are. Okay? First of all, remember, we're all here to have fun. Shout outs. Okay? And this could be a lot of fun. You don't need to make me your enemy. And I'm not saying anybody has. You know, over the course of this entire announcement, I might have seen three or four negative comments. One from Proud Boys Jack Buckby, who, really, I hope he's changed his tone because, let me tell you something. No, I love Jack Buckby. He's a great guy. But this isn't the show to hate on. We, along with you, hate on everybody else. Okay? So we welcome you to join us. Redbar has been around for a while, as you'll see. And you'll get to know the program with time. I think it's better that way. I like to keep things organico. Okay? I like to keep things natural. So I don't even really type up show notes. I make some notes here and there of stuff maybe that I want to cover, but I don't set myself up like that. I try to go with whatever I'm in the mood to talk about. So as far as the chat goes, yeah, don't talk shit about me. That's about it. We'll ban you. Okay? Why would I want to stare at the chat and read a bunch of terrible things about me? You know? So let's team up. We're giving you an invitation to join us and shit on everybody else. It'll be a lot of fun. And then the other rule is don't be an autist. I know there's a lot of you out there that like to fucking gab and gab and gab and shout out whatever's on your mind. But, you know, if you're too annoying in the chat, we're going to throw you up. But hopefully we won't have to do that. So log on to redbarradio.net/chat. We definitely need you. Oh, shit. They're saying Jack Cuckboy. Jack Fuckboy. They're talking about Jack Buckby. Do you guys know him? Oh, shout outs to the Proud Boys. Uhuru. I have a gift for the Proud Boys, okay? Because a lot of people, they don't really understand how much I want to, you know, be a friend to all you guys, okay? They go, I don't know about this guy. Never heard of him. Why should you have heard of me? So as a gift to the Proud Boys, Gavin McInnes' group, I've done something really crazy, and we're gonna see how that turns out. So today, somewhere during the show today, we're gonna tune into a live feed. Okay. And I've arranged a little gift for the Proud Boys, okay, to show them how legit I am. Cause I know they have doubts, and I understand those doubts. So to show them how much I support them and what they're doing, I have a little gift. And in a little bit, we're going to tune in live to a live feed where I've set up something to really show the Proud Boys that I am legit, that you could trust me. And I think once you see that, you'll go, oh, okay, this guy's on our side. So, yeah, somebody's saying Jack Buckby fucks Lady Alchemy. Yeah, Jack Buckby, somebody in the Proud Boys group. And somebody in the Proud Boys group. And like I said, really, I thought during this announcement, every enemy that I've ever made since 2003, because I'm very mean, I thought every enemy was going to come out of the woodwork. Oh, now's the perfect time to throw this dude. They didn't. There was really very, very few negative comments. So thank you. And thanks, everyone, for the support. Blah, blah, blah. But in the Proud Boys group, you know, one of these guys goes, what's with this Redbar show? I don't get it. Let me tell you something. If you got it right away, we'd have a problem. Okay? You don't want to get it right away. Anything cool takes a little time to get. But or maybe you won't get it at all. But this guy in the Proud Boys group said, I don't get it. And then this Jack Buckby guy. Do you know Jack Buckby? He's one of these British alt-right guys. WikiLeaks has an astounding announcement. You know these guys? There's another guy like that. You know these guys who YouTube themselves and they're British and they have very important announcements about the alt-right? That's Jack Buckby. And he said something like, yeah, I checked it out when this guy was on Gavin. I just don't really understand it. This guy's been doing it since 2003. And I wanted to say to him, I go, you know, Jack, maybe your late nights of picking Lady Alchemy's brain have got you all tired. You're making mistakes, bro. So, yeah, you know, I'm definitely not going to deal with any of that shit. Jack, I am extending my friendship to you here. You know, you made mistakes. You're probably one of these alpha guys. You see me come around, you start going, oh, shit. Can't have this guy around. So we definitely need Jack Buckby to apologize. And I think that's going to be the first thing we do on this show is force an apology out of him. You know, he's only got a couple thousand Twitter followers. How powerful could this man be? But yeah, this is a guy who dates Lady Alchemy. And he's talking about he doesn't enjoy me. Oh, I'm so sorry. And not to say that Lady Alchemy isn't the best. She is wonderful. But, you know. Imagine sitting with her. I understand. Oh, you just joined the right, Lady Alchemy. Congratulations. So many important things to say. So we want basically, you know, what I was worried about. Whenever you do this, all of a sudden, you know, these diehard Cumia fans, diehard Gavin fans. Now you see me coming. I'm yelling. And you might be like, fuck this. But why fuck this? We're all on the same network here. I want to be friends. That's what I'm asking. So give the show 3 episodes. Let's be friends. And like I said, nobody's complaining about it. But I would like to be friends with everybody, okay? So let's get this thing rolling. Just kidding. Did you see Talib Starks, by the way? Talib Starks started a week before me on the network. Shout-outs to Talib. Or Khalib. I've got a clip from his show. If you guys haven't seen it, it's very funny. So let's see. Hold on a sec. And yeah, a lot of the show doesn't, wait. Okay. So here's a clip from Talib Stark's show. So you guys can get, interested in this. Just a shout out to, Talib. We joined the network at the same time. Here's a little clip from his show.
Hey there. It's me again. Talib. Your boy Marvo. And I'm back with round 2. Marvo! Freestyle battle. We have 2 new contestants. Sophomore right here, and your boy Eli from class of 2005. We also have the bus, Jonathan Hodges, J-Dub, Jeremy Wallace, and Steven Jackson, Action Jackson,
Talib over there, my homie.
Y'all already know the rules, so we ain't gonna waste no time on that. But look, y'all will have 45 seconds. Please stop.
So there, a little bit of Talib Stark's show. Shoutouts to Talib. I'm so glad that we're working together now. This guy is my homie. So, yeah, we've got a lot of stuff to do today here. But, yeah, I'm kind of confused. Like, do I have to explain the whole show? Do I have to, you know, where do you start with all this? One of the things I did want to show you was Niggers Bop, okay, which you might have heard. Niggers Bop is a famous song that I wrote. Not a lot of people give me credit for this song. Haha, this is a classic. I'm just reading the chat here. Seems like a good show. Haha, this show is awful. Who the fuck is this man cow? Why do people keep calling me man cow? You know, that's pretty fucked up. So, I did this song called Niggers Bop, and I got a lot of cred for it. And it's a show that it's a song that trolls use to troll people with. And I wanted to show everybody, because a lot of people are like, who is this guy? Just like this guy in the chat, he goes, who is this man cow ripoff? Well, I'm going to show you who I am, you know, because not everybody here knows me. So I want to show you Niggers Bop. And you might have seen this on YouTube. You might have heard this song playing, you know, in chat rooms and such. Here it is. Niggers Bop DuckTales theme song. 1,700,000 views. It's a very famous song. And I'm going to play it for you just so you could get acquainted. Here we go.
Life is like a nigger here in Old Nicks. I hate fucking niggers. Niggers suck dick. They're all poor like Obama. Fuck Michelle Obama. Niggers, I hate them. They are stupid and they can't do taxes.
Wait. I gotta interrupt now. This is the problem I'm having with our new chat. Mike shouldn't act like he runs the place on his first day. I'm not trying to act like that. Is that what it comes off as? And this is a fan of ours. Mike shouldn't act like he runs the place on the first day. Cameron, get him out of here. It's our first band. Redbar, you're banned. Stop calling this guy Man Cow. He's not crying and he's not even a D cup. Yeah, we knew this was going to happen. First Lund of Redbar, Mike really doesn't. Oh, no, don't say that. So, yeah, we don't want to have any of that in the chat. You know, why would you want to give me a hard time on my first day? Let's go back to the song, okay? I'm not trying to run the place. I'm trying to have a fun time with everybody. You guys are going to see very shortly how much fun we're having. Song is too triggered, plus play. Who the fuck is Mark Davis? This always brings tears to my eyes. Western values, best values. Uhuru. Okay, let's go back to the song. Because this is a good way to introduce you to me. We're going to start it from the top, okay? Here we go. Let's have a drink.
Life
to Cumia.
Is like a nigger here in Old Nicks. I hate fucking niggers. Niggers suck dick. They're all poor like Obama. Fuck Michelle Obama. Niggers, I hate them. They are stupid and they can't do taxes. Niggers. Niggers are so dumb and they are also poor. Niggers. Look at niggers. They're trying to raise money, but they can't cause they spend all their money. They're niggers and they're so fucking niggers. I hate them. Niggers and niggers don't know how to do anything without chicken. Niggers like watermelon and chicken. Niggers. Niggers are so stupid and they're niggers. Woo woo. Niggers.
So shout outs to whoever uploaded that. So years ago, on an after show, we were doing some karaoke, and that was kind of a freestyle that we did. And now it's been used as this song to troll people. So you might have heard that. And I wanted to show you what happened. We actually made the news. I was talking about this on show 00. This was, you know, like I said, a song used by trolls all the time, and somebody relabeled it. Somebody took this song and relabeled it as Jay-Z's Niggas in Paris. And this high school football team, you know, this poor kid, this poor black kid was downloading songs and he was finding YouTube songs to play during this high school football game. And he wanted to do Jay-Z's Niggas in Paris. Kanye West, the edited version. Ball so hot, motherfuckers wanna find me. Or whatever that song goes. And somebody uploaded this and retitled it as Jay-Z's Niggers in Paris, clean version. So he downloaded it and he brought it to school and they were having this big football game and, you know, this all black high school. And this happened. So check this out. Let's go to the news. A lot of people asking questions. Who's this Redbar guy? What has he done? This is our one of our biggest claim to fames here.
Video now circulating on social media showing a racially offensive song being played over the loudspeaker at a homecoming football game in Henrico. This happened at Glen Allen.
She looks good, doesn't she? Dress is about as green as her skin. That is a bad look. If you have black skin like that, you probably don't want to match it with a green that's so similar.
Song being played over the loudspeaker at a homecoming football game in Henrico. This happened at Glen Allen when the varsity team took on the visiting team from John Marshall in Richmond. School administrators are now apologizing. Henrico reporter Ashley Momford live outside that school. Ashley, what went on here?
Well, there's a lot of outrage over this song. Now, Henrico administrators tell me a Glen Allen student was in charge of that song playlist, and they believe that student inserted the offensive song the day of the homecoming. Glen Allen and John Marshall's varsity football teams were warming up for homecoming when this song came on.
There it goes.
They're trying to raise money.
That's me.
Lucas Harris, a former John Marshall football player, started recording.
At first, I was wondering if I heard that right. Yeah, we were all very surprised, all very shocked, offended.
The racially offensive song is a parody of the cartoon DuckTales theme song. We found it aired on a comedy talk radio show and was posted to YouTube.
They're and they're so
that's me singing it.
I hate them!
Harris says John Marshall coaches reacted quickly to calm players. The school is predominantly African American.
Really, that just ignited us, gave us motivation to go out there and win. And we played our best game of the year. We really came together as a family. Everybody played their best game of the year.
Henrico school administrators also reacted quickly. This letter of apology was sent from the Glen Allen principal to the John Marshall principal.
Oh, dear.
She says she's appalled and says, quote, this unfortunate incident does not reflect the broader Glen Allen community.
It's inappropriate. It's actually
you think so?
Vulgar and obscene.
Henrico School Board Chair John Montgomery had this to say.
There was a young person involved, and it'll be a learning moment for them as well. And if we need to make some adjustments, which we probably will to our process,
yeah, you probably should
promptly so it won't happen again.
And more apologies may be due in the future.
The person who did it, do you think that they need to apologize to the coaches, to the John Marshall football team in person?
I would appreciate that.
Oh, yeah?
John Marshall staff, coaches, players, they would all appreciate that very much.
Look at this woman.
Disciplinary action is being taken against the student responsible. Montgomery says that the school board is suggesting that that student also apologize in person to the John Marshall community. Henrico school board officials also reached out to Richmond school board officials apologizing for the incident as well. On your side in Henrico, I'm Ashley Monfort, NBC 12 News.
Fuck yeah. So that should give us a little bit of street cred, huh? So that happened. It was actually big. It was on all the news sites. And at the end of the day, it kind of was funny how it turned out because the media, you know, threw this kid under the bus, this poor black student who accidentally played the song, and they were really coming down on him. They wanted to suspend him at the school and all this stuff happened. Long story short, at the end of the day, I came out the victor. Okay, I was talking about this on episode 00. Yeah, what even happened with that? It was something like, we caught the media lying. Yeah, we ended up catching the media lying. You know, they were talking about this school and all this racial tension at the school. And we caught the media lying. We exposed it. And all the kids thanked me. They gave me a big round of applause and they were sending emails. Even the black kid who was on trial there at his school for playing the song reached out to personally thank me. So it was a very nice moment. So if you've heard that song before, that's me. And that's about all I got as far as famous things that I've done. So, yeah, I got to admit, this is kind of weird. I don't like introductory shows. I'm so used to having everybody know exactly what I'm about. And now I feel like everybody's waiting for me to explain myself. So fuck that shit. I've been in a terrible mood since the Cubs won. It's something I didn't want to win. Something I didn't want to happen. I don't know if you watched the World Series, but did you see all these fucking losers? There's one thing that I couldn't do. I'm a completely opposite person from the person who could sit in the stands and go, go Cubs, go. Go Cubs, go. I'm a faggot. You're a faggot. Go Cubs, go. Or whatever the fuck they sing. How could a person seriously sing that? That was the one problem that I had with the game. I really, I tuned in thinking that I was going to hate it, but I got addicted to it. Hold on a sec. All right, we're having a mega problem here. And I'm going to be perfectly honest with you. I ain't feeling this shit right now. I think the pressure has gotten to me. I honestly believe that. We need to reset or something. I feel it in my brain. So for those people who listen to the show, you know that I'm brutally honest with what's going on in my head, and I don't like to fake stuff. And I just realized I'm kind of going through the motions here. I'm kind of going, oh, so, you know, I had this other story in my head that I wanted to explain to people. And I honestly don't feel too comfortable right now, which is very weird because on the last show, I couldn't have felt more comfortable. I couldn't have felt more myself. And today, now I'm sitting here going, you know, all this pressure, all these new people, you got to make them all, you know that you're the bomb. And it really feels icky instead of fun. So we got to get that fun vibe going. And don't anybody feel down about this. A lot of these shows start like this. Well, they haven't in a very long time. But a lot of these shows can start like this and then turn into the most fun shows of our lives. Usually I start, oh, let's try some booze here. Let's try some weed. But, I'm not feeling like I'm really, you know, in that crushing mood yet. So I got to do something about that mood. What could we do? Should I try smoking a little La Weeda? I feel like I'm acting like Talib Starks. This must be, you know what it must be? It must be the pressure of having to do something like this must just be, too shitty to be able to have fun. Remember when Cumia had his first show and we all knew him from Opie and Anthony, and then he had those first shows and he had a couple of shows where he's out and back by the pool and he was drinking a lot. Remember that show with Andrew Dice Clay? See, this is where it got started, where people said, oh, he talks a lot of shit about Cumia. So do you remember that? You remember when Cumia was sitting there, he was pounding drinks and it was just a new situation. So he kept saying stuff like, ah, you know, what are we going to do? And we were sitting back and we were going, yeesh, cringe. And then he jumped into the pool and he was trying to, you know, but I know how he feels. It is very tough, you know, getting in front of a giant new group of people, you know, and anybody who is comfortable doing that. You know, a lot of people don't know me. I don't want to be an entertainer. You know, I don't live for the applause. I'm not one of these Dane Cooks who day after day could get up on a stage and bomb and bomb and bomb. But I keep pushing forward because I really need those laughs. You know, this show started because I just wanted to talk, you know, and it was fun talking into microphones years ago, 2003. And I always just did the show because I needed to. Because I had shit to talk about. And then when you put people like me in these type of situations where you go, here you go, you're on. You go, ugh. So it is kind of an icky feeling. You saw Talib Stark's first show. Not throwing him under the bus. But it is. It's like, I got to show all these people what I got next. So we got to fuck off with that whole vibe. And I always feel it. You can feel it. As a person who does these type of shows, you really can feel it in your brain. And you could feel yourself going, okay, I'm not really connecting to what I'm saying. And I'm kind of just trying to, you know, go through the stuff that I had thought about in my head. And you can't do that. You can't let yourself start going on this weird journey of trying to cover the stuff that you went over in your head before, because it'll never work. It'll sound stilted. It'll sound fake. You know, that's why I didn't want to come up with too much for the show. I'm the type of person who, you know, a week before I'll go, oh, cool. I want to talk about that on the show and I'll put it in my notes. And then by the time the show comes, you don't really want to talk about it because you're not feeling the passion. So I always like to keep it like whatever we talk about on the show, I want it to be right here, right now. This is the stuff that I'm really into. This is the stuff that I'm passionate about. So, it does throw you off a little bit. So I'm going to admit it. I'm not going to be a fagoot and try to push through it, you know? And, oh shit, did I just screw myself? Did I just make myself look really bad by going, oh boy? No, I think it's better to be honest, and I guess that's a great example of the man that I want to be for you guys. You know, if it's not working out, we're just going to tell you it's not working out, and we're going to go from there. But I don't like the fakery where it's like, well, we got this topic here, let's go cover it. Do a hang, let's check in on some fools. Yeah, we're gonna get it together here in a moment. Let's smoke some weed, let's reset, let's have some fun. Well, this is fucking awkward now. No, I don't want to make you think that it's awkward. It's really not. You know, it really is just the first show jitters. They are there. I didn't know they would come either. Really, I was thinking about it like it's no sweat. This is my show. This is what I do. This is my room. This is where I sit. But, and even before the show, I was feeling totally fine. But I got to admit, yeah, it feels like there's more pressure. Cameron Malik in the chat, our web developer, reaching out, saying, just smoke your fucking weed. Christ Rider, stop being a fag. Well, Redbar lasted 1 week on Cumia. Yep. No. We always recover. Oh boy. I honestly don't know where to go to yet. We could do this. Let's do this. Let's get into some stuff that I really despise right now. No, honestly. We are 4 days away from the election, and I'm not an electioneer. I'm not somebody who really gives a shit as much as most of you do. You know, you follow Twitter and you go, look at these people. They have dedicated their lives to the election. They're following it day in and day out. They're posting, and it's almost like they're working for the campaign. They're every little piece of minutia that comes out about the election, they've got to be constantly on top of, and I proved you wrong and you proved me right. And you go, how could this be a fun way to live life? Now, I was all for the Trumpster when he first started because it was fucking funny. But then you go, look at all these people. They're fucking in hell. You know, and last week I was in a real bad place with it all. I go, this election, it's not funny anymore. You know, it's not funny when 50% of people all hate each other. You know, you got the Hillary supporters and you got the Trump supporters and they all hate each other. And I know we want to, you know, when I started this, I was like, fuck yeah, we're going to get Trump in. This is going to rule. And I think I'm back to that now, actually. But last week I was freaking out and I was going, or not last week, a couple weeks ago. Yeah, it was kind of, maybe I smoked too much weed, but I was thinking, you know, it's not good. You know, I know you want Trump in and I know fuck all those people, but you know, they're still here and you still got to live with them. So how do you say fuck off to 50% of the country? Well, maybe you have to. But now it seems like, have you guys noticed this tone this week? It's been kind of pro-Trump. It looks like he's kind of the man again. I haven't seen it. Almost like, did everybody blow their load on all the Trump hate? Now it's like a week before the election. It seems like people have kind of lost steam with that. You know, because I'm not seeing I'm not seeing as much hate as I thought I would see coming to the election. It seems like people have slowed down with that. And it seems like all the stuff that they've been saying about Trump is kind of worn off. You know, you got Lena Dunham's new rap video that we have to check out today. The sack of potatoes, Lena Dunham. And you've got this vote video by Amy Schumer that I want to check out. But it seems like all their stuff, even the grab the pussy stuff, has kind of worn up. By the way, grab the pussy. I do have one complaint about the grab the pussy movement there. On the grab the pussy day, you had everybody covering it the same way. Kind of the same way, which I thought was very hack. You had everyone go, how do you even grab somebody by the pussy? I mean, how's it? Everybody was so stumped by that. Why? What was that? Did that stump you? You've never. And you had on every show that discussed the grab the pussy thing that Trump said.
You could grab him by the pussy.
They all said, how do you even grab someone by the pussy? It's really not that complicated, and you shouldn't really be talking about it. And I despise anybody that did. It was really sickening. Even Doug Benson did it on Getting Doug with High. It's like they all laugh about it as if they're the first person to say, how do you even grab somebody by the pussy? You take your hand and you cut, you just grab that area. It's been my move since day one. When I was a kid, I didn't, the fingering was a bit much for me. When I was in like, when did people start fingering? Fifth? Sixth? It was a bit much for me. I think when the fingering first began, girls, I didn't know what I was doing, and I might have been even a bit afraid of it. And I remember everybody was talking, ooh, I fingered Stacy, I fingered Allie. You know, and I'm going, oh, this fingering seems like it's really starting to pick up. I should probably do that to the next girl. And I would always kind of just kind of go down there and kind of just rub, you know, and I didn't want to kind of get my finger in. I didn't know where I was going with it. So I would kind of do this move where I cupped and rubbed and basically cut to, you know, spoiler alert. That's pretty much what you want to be doing right now. You want to take the hand and you just want to be rubbing. You know, I talk to girls all the time and I, you know, perform these moves on these women. And I don't think they really care for this finger jamming stuff. So grab the pussy to me is what you do. You grab the crotch, you cup, you push. Pretty much every girl, they like that. So I don't understand why everybody was head over heels with the grab the pussy comment, like something they had never thought of before. I felt very alone at that time, thinking that I was the only person who's ever, you know, grabbed one of those. Not that I like to talk about that kind of stuff on the show, but. So you had that stuff, and now I see you've got Lena Dunham, and you've got Amy Schumer, and you've got this music video where they're talking about grab the pussy, but I think that kind of stuff has died off. This guy might win. So I am back to being a Trump supporter, everybody. No, I can't. I'm going to tell you something after I play this video. I definitely can't be involved. I'm one of these people. To me, it's somebody telling you what to do. Go vote. You know, I'm not into that shit. Since when did being a patriot become something cool people do? So I want to show you this video. This is Amy Schumer telling people to go vote, but it does seem like we really might see Trump win. And I'm very excited about the election night. Cumia is having an election night special, so people are going to be tuned into that. They're going to be watching the whole thing. I'm going to be up all night here with Sven, and we might go live, not to compete with Cumia, but I think we might just want to be on live and just show our hangout here live, because that is going to be one of the funner nights. Have we really thought about it? I mean, with 4 days away, you're thinking, like, do you do that thing where you're talking to your friend and you go, oh my God, we have this election coming up. Like, this is going to be one of the funner, more stimulating things of our entire life. Like, no matter what happens with it, we get to sit up all night with everybody watching some of the best fools TV out there and watching this thing really go down and watching those states light up. And I'm just super excited. I'm super excited about the hang and the fun time everybody's going to be having doing that. And imagine the posts. Imagine what the posts are going to be like that day, the day after. I was thinking of what I could write, you know, the day after. I think it's just going to be ha, 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 ha. You know, no matter who wins. But this is just going to be a really fucking crazy thing to watch and a really fun time. And now I'm kind of going, you know, 2 weeks ago, and I'm not on the fence at all. I'm not voting, and I'll tell you why in a little bit. But I am a Trump supporter in terms of I support this kind of behavior. I do. And to all the people who are offended by Trump, I'd like to see them be less offended instead of changing the man's behavior. Now, I understand as far as president goes, okay, you've got a guy not fit to be president. That is something I don't give a fuck about. I don't think anybody's fit to do anything. Have you seen people? Have you met people? Have you seen them in their business places? Have you gone to the post office? Our post office here in Chicago, Illinois, you might live in a small town populated by the whites. They have a very friendly post office. If you go into a post office in a white small town, they know your name. They greet you. They're very friendly. When you go to a post office here in Chicago, it's like an In Living Color sketch. It's literally a black person filing the nails. Mm-hmm. You're going to have to wait. They have at my post office, they have a 4'2" Korean woman who, she wouldn't be successful, you know, as the wife of a husband who runs a liquor store. She's in no position to do anything. And you'll see the line will build up out the door. And they, you know, complain when people come up to the counter and they can't help you with anything. So, you know, nobody's fit to do these jobs. And why the fuck should I care all of a sudden? Why all of a sudden is everybody so responsible? Nobody just wants to have fun anymore? You know, but a couple weeks ago, I really was feeling, you know, I keep going back to it. I go, it's kind of irresponsible to vote Trump in. I know we all want to blow it up and that would be funny. But now this week, I'm thinking again back to that, oh, who gives a fuck? No, that would rule if Trump's in. That would actually be pretty cool. You know, because every one of my enemies is anti-Trump, I believe. Almost every one of them. So I can't imagine, you know, them winning with Hillary. I don't want to see them all exciting, going, yes, we told you so. It feels personal to me. I think that's what they don't get about the election. It's almost like a personal thing. It's like Trump represents not the policies or ideas that I'm interested in, but he represents kind of the kind of guy I am in a way where it's like, I feel like I'm not saying anything bad, but everybody's freaking out about it, you know, because in Trump's mind, he's not going, you know, and coming up with something evil to say. To him, this isn't a big deal. And I wonder if it would just be better to teach everybody, hey, just fucking don't let that, that's nothing. Don't let that bother you. Don't be insulted by that. But no, they're doing the complete opposite. So the first time that he came out, and this could have been politically driven, but, you know, I had a huge problem with how the media handled Trump coming out and saying, you know, they're rapists, they're racist, they're doing this. When I saw that video, immediately I said, the illegal immigrants. Yeah, the illegal immigrants. Yeah, I live in a Mexican neighborhood. This is how they act. They're insane. They're psycho. They don't even know how to speak. They walk around. They throw, you know, Doritos bags all over the floor. So when I heard him say that, there was no problem with that. And then I saw the media take that line and turn it into Mexicans are rapists. All. Remember this? All Mexicans are rapists. All Mexicans. And I said, but then somebody said it all. This is crazy. And I'm pretty, I thought to myself that that would be cleaned up pretty quickly. You know, you figured that, this media outlet said that he called all Mexicans racist and rapist. But, you know, they'll clean that up in a week. And that never came. That cleanup never came. They kept it. All Mexicans are racist. All Mexicans are rapists. I mean, not all Mexicans. Jesus fucking Christ. All Mexicans are rapists. And that's when I knew this is fucked. You know, this whole thing is fucked. They took that story. They ran with it. And it was the beginning of the end. You know, it really was. And I kept waiting for somebody to go, guys, we can't let the media just say this. And then I was watching Bill Maher, which is a show all of you should watch, even if you're on the right. You should be getting a little bit of everything. You know, you can't just be listening to Milo. You can't. You're going to go crazy. You're going to end up like that guy, Alan J. Erickson, on the Young Turks. I know you guys all think he's lit, but let me tell you something. This guy's fucking retarded. So, you're watching Bill Maher, and remember he brought on that Mexican guy, the head of the Mexican network over there, the Mexican TV station. And he repeated the same thing that the lying media was saying. He's calling all Mexicans, rapists and, burglars. And then he said, what did he say that was really the top? He goes, these are not, oh yeah, this is what he said. He goes, this is the president of some giant Mexican television company or something. He goes, these are not illegals. These are not illegals. They are people. And everybody, woo! Yes! They're people. Yeah, we know they're people. But the weirdest part to me was that the whole illegal immigrant thing became like this thing of hate and not a thing of a broken law, which is what it is. And that was the weirdest thing to me. That was the first time I said, okay, these people don't care about the truth or what's important. They're saying that, oh, we don't really care if illegal immigrants break the law. And to me, that's all that it's ever been about. I got hit. I always tell this story that I was driving. This is back when I had a Honda Accord. What a sick ride. And I was driving. I stop at a stoplight and I get hit from the back by a pickup truck. And, you know, the police come and all this stuff, and we're standing there, and the police come to my window, and they're knocking, and goes, so, they don't have insurance, so nothing really we could do here as far as insurance goes, so, you know, you're going to have to fix this on your own. I go, wait a minute, what do you mean they don't have insurance? Well, they're illegal immigrants here, they don't have insurance. It's two Mexican guys. I go, oh, so you'll be arresting them and then deporting them, right? And he goes, oh, nothing really we could do about it. What do you mean nothing? If I was driving my car without a license or insurance, when I get pulled over, they arrest me and they put me in jail. But if you're an illegal immigrant and you get pulled over, you don't have insurance or a license, they just go, you're illegal. And then you're on with your way. So to me, that was very fucked. I kind of get it now, but when I was 18 or 19, back when that happened, I said, I was very confused at why they weren't taken out of the car, cuffed, arrested, and then sent back. And I don't know why that can't be the solution today. Why is nobody even bringing that up? Why can't the solution be that if you're an illegal immigrant, fine, we can't go door to door. You know how they all say, well, you can't go door to door, knock on all the doors and start deporting them all. You know, that would cost millions of dollars. It'd be crazy. You'd break up families. Yeah. Why can't it just be, hey, if we catch you doing a crime, the officer pulls you over and, hey, I do not have an ID. Okay, well, now we just arrest you. They put you in a holding cell and you await deportation. Wouldn't that solve the problem? And wouldn't it, send a message to, hey, don't break the law? And then you wouldn't have any of those bad guy illegal immigrants, because if they got caught breaking the law, they'd be sent back right away. Why can't we just do that? So then we saw, and I don't know if it was just because Trump brought it up, but we saw it's almost like the rest of the country, the left, they don't want to consider illegal immigration to be illegal. And I don't know why they don't just come out and say that. Why don't they just come out and say, hey, guys, we just want people to come into the country. We don't consider it illegal. But if it is illegal, if it's still in the law books, like it's illegal to be here without being a tax-paying citizen, then why aren't they sent back? And why is it such a huge problem to say, I want to combat that issue? So that was the first time we heard about Trump, and he said that. And I said, yeah, I agree with that. That's a common-sense move. It's not a Republican move. Shouldn't be a Democrat move. It should be, hey, do you agree with that we have a system of laws here in the United States? Well, then we got to follow that one. I knew things were awry when he first started running, and then they took everything he said and they made it out to be the worst. And at the end of the day, you're left with this guy who, yeah, on paper, it does sound like he's plenty unfit to be the president of the United States. But, you know, I would just ask, you know, really look at yourself, you know, and really look around and go, are you really as serious? Are you such a serious person? Do you really abide by the law and these constitutions and all this nonsense? Are you such a patriot now all of a sudden? What happened to having a little fun, figuring out how to cheat life, figuring out how to not do shit that sucks? Whatever happened about that? Hillary Clinton, Donald Trump, these people that you're... Obango! They don't have the recipe for life. They're trying to follow a million laws, and they're trying to please everybody. But that has nothing to do with real life. There's plenty of other options. So this coming election... I will not be voting. I'm going to say that again. So let's roll Amy Schumer's clip and let's hear what she has to say personally to me. This is the bloated Amy Schumer. We're 4 days away from the election here. Amy Schumer constantly says she doesn't want problems with people. She's so sick. Oh, why do people troll me? Why do people do this? And constantly antagonizing people with stuff like this. So let's see if this sets me off. I watched a little bit of this. This is Amy Schumer. She posted this 23 hours ago. So not many people have seen this yet. It's called hashtag I will vote. It's a video. Hey, America. So let's check this out. This is our pal, Amy Schumer.
Hey, America. Whoops. It's me, professional hand model, Amy Schumer. But I'm not here to show perfect hands, even though they are perfect, and a lot of people like them. And I'm not here to tell you to vote. Whether you're a cool, good citizen or a steamy dump, it's totally 100% your call. But I am here to tell you something important that everyone has a right to know, but doesn't. Here it comes. You ready? People are going
to
know if you voted or not.
Listen
to this.
Voting
history is public record. It doesn't say who you voted for. But it says if you voted at all.
That's a little bit of a threat. And you're being a little bit of a bitch. You know, Amy, I don't think people hate you because you're a woman. There are a lot of women on this planet who go out day in and day out. They don't have any problems. I have a very wonderful wife who never, ever comes home and says to me, man, I was hated on by so many men. Men are so terrible. They really hate women. Nobody hates my wife because she's nice. We hate women that are pigs. We also don't like watching somebody balloon up in front of our eyes. You know, I think in our DNA, we know how unhealthy it is to get fat. So when you watch somebody on social media who, you know, I'm not saying Amy Schumer is attractive. And if you think Amy Schumer is attractive, we have a very, very big problem. Amy Schumer is an obese person. If you think this body type is the new normal, you've gone too far. Amy Schumer is extremely obese. She's extremely puffy. And most of this weight, it comes from guzzling down booze till 3 a.m. every night with her pals, her unhealthy pals. So I don't want to hear that, oh, you know, every woman has a different body shape. Every woman has a different body type. You know, we're not in control of this. Amy Schumer is slamming down. She's guzzling food. We've seen her sister. Her sister is a mess. And she's bitchy. You know, it comes down to that. It's like we talk about Beyonce, Jada Pinkett Smith. What do all these women have in common? It's their little bitchiness. They talk to us like we're pieces of shit. They're snarky. You know, listen to this. And the creativity is zilch. Hi, it's me, Amy Schumer, a hand model. Why is that funny? Because your hands are fucking bloated. They look like they've been hit with a hammer. Is that why that's so funny? But I thought you're a normal looking woman, so why can't you be a hand model? It doesn't add up.
Hey America, it's me, professional hand model, Amy Schumer. But I'm not here to show you my perfect hands, even though they are perfect, and a lot of people like them. And I'm not here to tell you to vote. Whether you're a cool, good citizen or a steamy dump, it's totally 100% your call. But I am here to tell you something important that everyone has a right to know, but doesn't. Here it comes, you ready? People are going to know if you voted or not. Your voting history is public record. It doesn't say who you voted for, but it says if you voted at all. Anyone who knows you can just look that shit up. Uh-oh.
And why would somebody know? Not uh-oh. Why would somebody who knows me look that up? That's insane.
Did Mike vote?
And where do you even look that up? I've never heard of that ever. So what is this, your last threat to America? If you don't come out and vote for Hillary, we're going to look you up and notice that you didn't vote? Am I the only person on the planet? I need to ask. I want to take a survey in the chat. I got to take a survey in the chat. Because this isn't connecting with me at all. Since a very early age, I want to tell everybody, I've never voted for anything in my life. Okay, I'm 33 years old. I've never once voted. Now, that is looked at as the worst. Louis C.K. called me an asshole the other day when he was on, who was he on? Jimmy Fallon, Trump, one of those fags. Louis C.K. called me an asshole. I'm constantly being told to rock the vote. And then I constantly see you guys, you know, regardless of what side you're on. When I talked about this, you know, earlier this year, people on Twitter, when I said that I wasn't going to vote. And each side came after me. Are you serious? Do you understand that not voting is just going to put Hillary in office? Guys, this isn't my thing. I don't partake in this nonsense. Why do I have to be a part of it? So yeah, that's where I don't understand. Where does this, when did you all become such patriots? Where this is your duty? So press one in the chat if you think it is an asshole move to not vote. I just want to see, because it's like the one thing where I've never truly understood the hate from that. I've never understood rock the vote. I've never understood this concept of you get up, you go vote. It doesn't matter. You just got to get out there and go vote. And that's what these people were saying all along. P. Diddy was the first one I remember when they were doing Rap the Vote on MTV. And P. Diddy was saying, it doesn't matter which candidate you like. It doesn't matter what you believe in. You get out there and you rock the vote. Get out there and vote. And it's like, he was talking directly to me and I go, I have no idea what I'm voting for. I don't know who these people are. You just want to get me out there and just start checking boxes. Okay. So we see people are calling me an asshole. They're pressing one. So I want to know, why is it so bad to not vote? Why is that like the worst thing you could do? See, to me, it seems like that's kind of like a sales pitch from people who want you to vote a certain way when they're telling you to get out there and vote. Okay, they're pressing two. Good, that means I'm not an asshole. So how many people are... Wait, hold on. Let's redo the survey here. Not everything is rigged. Hold on, I'm reading the chat here. Let's see, not everything's rigged. I didn't vote and I kind of regret it. Too late to register. I lie in a democratic state. Voting would be a waste of time. I hear that a lot from a lot of people. Now, I want others to go out and vote, and I want them to vote Trump in. Okay, this is going to be my official statement now. Fuck America. No. We got to have Trump, right? Not because of policy, not because of any of this stuff. But just because it would feel a little better, right? We don't connect to Hillary as a type of person. So we got to have Trump in. Does anybody disagree? Press, let's do this again because I have a couple of surveys going. If you're in the chat right now at redbarradio.net/chat, press 3 if you're voting for Trump, 4 if you're voting for Hillary. So 3 for Trump, 4 for Hillary, or 5 if you're completely not voting at all. Because I want to see. We actually have a choice. It goes against the... I'm reading the chat right now. RKO36. It goes against the principle of what makes America great. We're not some shithole like North Korea or Iraq where it doesn't matter anyway. So you guys really feel that on board. I'm one of these guys where it comes to stuff like school, the government, rules... These are things I don't want to. I'm not really a part of these things. Mike, why should anyone vote? 1 or 2? It's fucking close, man. You need to vote. Yeah, people are really into it. 3 for not voting. Wait, no, three is for Trump. This is really, okay, threes and fives. Okay, what does three mean again? Three is voting for Trump, four is voting for Hillary, and five is not voting at all. We have a lot of fives. Five, stay home. Fuck yeah, for the fives. Yeah. I don't really care. Maybe we should all go vote for Trump, though, just to fuck it up, which I thought was a completely irresponsible thing to do last month. I really did. I was getting high. I was getting real. You know, it felt like I was just really thinking about the world as a whole. And I said, you know what? We can't have neither of these people. This is terrible. We need to start over. These people should go home. We need to rethink how we're doing this whole thing. But now I think this would be kind of cooler. Also, I'm on Cumia. You know, you got to kind of, you know, now I'm a Trump guy. No, but three. Okay, so they're all saying Trump. So everybody in this chat is either voting for Trump or not voting at all. But there are a lot of fives. People who are not voting at all, which I think is the best way to go. I don't understand the whole rock the vote mentality. I don't understand. You have to vote. You are the worst possible person if you don't get out there and vote. Why? Why do I have to pick something that I'm not into? And not that, you know, I don't even want to be hack and be like, oh, how could you vote for the lesser of two evils? They're both so terrible. How about it's faggy? How about I don't want to be involved in political nonsense sponsored by the government? That's not my shit. I was born from a woman, you know, who thought it would be badass to have a baby because that's what families do. I didn't ask for any of this. I don't need to be involved. Why do I need, what responsibility do I have to this country? I don't have a choice. We are actually in, you know, it's very great. Thank you. Glad I wasn't born in the Congo. Okay. Yeah, obviously. You know, getting bit by mosquitoes, constantly swatting. You know what a black person in the Congo never does? Swats the flies from their sunset. They just let them. Zzz. Yeah, that would fucking suck, but, you know, I didn't ask to be fucking born. So, wait a minute. So you're a Trump guy because you're on Cumia? I just lost. It was a joke, son. No, I want Trump to win. But I'm not going to vote for him. I can't be responsible for it if it goes bad. And I do feel bad. I don't want everybody to hate each other. We can't have everybody hate each other. You know, that's fucking nuts. And we've gotten so addicted to being on one team or the other that it's all about winning and shoving in the face, which, you know what? See, but here's the thing. Last week, I was saying I don't want everyone to hate each other. Now I'm like, maybe they need to learn a little bit of a lesson. Maybe Sarah Silverman. Maybe Chelsea Peretti. Maybe Seth MacFarlane need to learn a thing or two about how much of a faggot they are. Have you seen Seth MacFarlane, Chelsea Peretti, all these people? They tweet and tweet and tweet and tweet about Trump, you know, 24/7. I mean, these people used to tweet out comedy, and now it's just Trump. Every cool comedian, you know, and I talk to him, every cool comedian is secretly saying, when did comedy become all about pop? Well, now I'm fucking... Hey, we're 4 days away from the election. I have to talk about the election. It's nuts. You know? This show really doesn't do political talk. It might seem like, I hope people from Redbar aren't watching this and go, oh, so he's really trying to election it up. Absolutely not. But we're 4 days away. It kind of is one of the biggest events. And whether you're into it, it was just like the World Series. I hated the World Series. I hated the fact that the Cubs, the city I'm from, was in the World Series. These Cubby people are the faggotiest people on earth. Go Cubs, go. Go Cubs. What drives a person to sit in the stands and sing something like that? Could you imagine? Could you imagine being so driven to sing a song that was just written for this World Series? So... But yeah, I watched the World Series and I was like, ah! At first, I wanted the Cubs to lose and I was like, here's how much bullshit sports is. Let me tell you how bullshit it is. It's so easy to get sucked in. Yeah, I saw Gavin the other week saying, I like baseball. Of course, if somebody takes you to a baseball game, especially these high-stakes games, you will be into baseball. It's a trick. Don't get sucked in. It's meaningless. Maybe if these people, if all the team members were from Chicago, I could see how it could mean something. But baseball is an easy trick. It's one of the easiest. Basketball, too. Immediately, you find yourself yelling at the screen. So, in my head, here, I hate sports. I hate the Chicago Cubs. We have the Chicago Cubs and the Chicago White Sox. And I grew up, my dad was a Sox fan. And he shit on the Cubs growing up. So my entire life was like, oh, the Cubs people are homos. And they are. If you see who Cubs fans are walking around, they're these blonde women. They've got no sense of what's going on in the world. They're pushing a stroller. They just moved to this nice area of Chicago. And they're going to move the fuck out once their kid has to go to school. But so I always thought the Cubs were very faggy and sports were very faggy. And the game five of the World Series was the day I decided I was going to pay attention. And I said, I really want the Cubs to lose. I just want all these faggots in Chicago to have to put their head back down, walk home. It ain't never happening. Stop getting so excited about sports. And so game five, I was watching and I was rooting almost instantly. I became the guy yelling at the screen, the guy that I've always mocked. I've never been that guy in my life. But because I made that decision in my head that Cubs need to lose, which was a joke decision, too. So this is why it was weird. You know, it was a gag decision. But I made that decision in my head. So similar to placing a bet on sports, it was very similar to that. It was like, I need to root for that decision I made. And I instantly became connected with that. And I was watching the game. You know, something that I've never done, never do. And every time Cleveland would score, I go, yes! And I go, what am I doing? And I was so excited. Then when it was that last game, the World Series there, the final event, I changed over and I automatically started rooting for the Cubs just because it's a better story. And I started thinking that in my head. And my wife was telling me that, how cool would that be? 108 years. So I got that idea in my head and I started rooting for the Cubs just as hard as I was rooting for the Indians. Oh, shit. Yeah, they're saying, Mike, remove this Amy picture from your screen. My boner is dead. No. You guys fuck Amy. I see what you guys say. How many beers? Huh, Proud Boys? Huh? How many beers has she had? This looks like a beer drink. No, we should get back to the Amy shirt. But the point was, once you pick a side and once you have an idea, it's so easy to get lost in this really weird spell of rooting for that team. And I found myself doing it for the Indians one night and the Cubs the next. And I'm one of these people who thinks that shit doesn't affect me. So why was I so sucked in? So easy. And then you see the entire city marching in this parade about the Cubs. And you go, what did they do that was so great? They have to play baseball, right? Okay. All the teams have to play. There's going to be one winner. You know? How excited could you be? Oh, so they won once in 108 years? Everybody won once in 108 years. Why are you so crazy about it? But I also get the excitement. I get how you could be excited because I've seen myself be there. And I think it comes down to a matter of, for some reason, we want to be excited about something, but we keep picking the wrong people. We keep picking the wrong teams and the wrong ideas to be excited about. We want the feeling the Cubs winning the World Series gives us. We want the feeling that Trump defeating Hillary gives us. And we want to believe that Amy Schumer is the best female comedian here to change the game. She ain't. The Cubs winning the World Series is just a bunch of fucking weirdos who don't even give a shit about the Cubs. What, the manager, whoever that guy is, the coach, he don't give a fuck. He comes on the screen every day on the news and he goes, oh, yeah, you know, I don't know, the Cubs won, so whatever. He doesn't seem to be too excited. None of these people care. Half of them are from shipped in from Cuba. So, yeah, it's like we know what we want and we keep attributing these things and these people and these events to that moment because we want to feel that moment where we won something or where we're getting better, or we made it. So you think it's baseball and you pretend, but I watched that fucking parade today and you go, all of these people are marching today and screaming and they dyed the Chicago River blue and there's more people out in Grant Park than Lollapalooza and there's people off the street. But these people literally, they spent turns throwing a ball and then hitting it with a bat and playing by these. That's really all you're celebrating at the end of the day, which is a little fucking cuckoo. It's the same thing as Amy Schumer, this pig here. They're celebrating her. See, this is why we hate her. She never was supposed to be celebrated. She should be Ari Shaffir level at most. Doing comedy clubs, that's it. But they wanted so badly to find a hero. To find the funniest woman. She doesn't give a fuck. She's killing it. She's changing the game. It ain't her. That would be great if there was a woman who did that. I would like her too. We want people like that. But you can't just pretend that those people exist. You can't just pretend that because Hillary's a woman, oh, this is great, the first woman president. I know we want the first woman president. Not us. But we want that moment. But that doesn't mean you just create it. And that's what they did with this woman. And that's why we hate her. We don't hate her because she's a girl. We hate her because she shouldn't be here. She shouldn't be here right now telling me to go and vote with 4 million views. She should just be doing feature act comedy, you know, throughout the city. So let's back this up. Let's hear this again, because this I found to be pretty offensive.
Voting history is public record. It doesn't say who you voted for, but it says if you voted at all. Anyone who knows you can just look that shit up. Uh-oh. You gotta actually go out and vote and not just pretend like you did at dinner parties. Your decision to vote or not is obviously up to you.
Who's doing that?
Judging you for that decision could be up to the internet, and everyone has access to that, even our parents. Hey, so did you get a chance to vote? Of course, I care about this country. Oh, really? Because I looked it up and you didn't vote.
How do you care about the country when you literally don't care about your own body? Do you see the fucking double chin? Do you see the bags and the puffiness in her face? How could you be? I could understand. I could understand if you were a person that just really cared about human beings. You know, if you really cared about human beings and you were starting with every aspect of that, then I could see you caring about the country this much. But how can you possibly care about the country so much when you obviously don't give a fuck about yourself? Look what you're wearing. Every time they got her on TV or at an award ceremony, they got her dressed up like a, you know, a fictional old-timey character from American Horror Story Asylum or something. Or, some old-timey play. Look what she's wearing. Where do you even get a bow like that? You know, a pioneer's bow. She's got some, it looks like her name is Beverly, and she's 65 years old. This woman's got no style. So, yeah, there's a lot of things. Very, very small mouth. You know, if you want to make fun of Trump for small hands, look at Amy Schumer's mouth right now. That thing's about this big. It's the size of a couple quarters overlapped.
I'm a steamy dump. I hope that people don't blame you if an orange sexually assaulting Godzilla who started a fake college is fucking up the entire planet a year or so from now. That would be a bummer, right? Okay, so I guess I am actually here to tell you to vote. Or at least cover your own ass so that you don't seem like a steamy dump. I don't want that for you. I don't want that for you, baby.
You don't.
What do you want to vote for?
This is all acting. That's the other thing. Look at her face. See any confidence in those eyes? This isn't a girl who knows what she's talking about coming to crush it. This is a person who was put in that position because the agents wanted it, the managers wanted it, the media loved the story. They want this person that doesn't exist yet. You know, why not just give it to Joan Rivers? See, they think they want this person, but when you do have a real woman who says whatever she wants, it's like Joan Rivers, and then the media ignores her because Joan Rivers kind of hates her. You know what I mean? The Amy Schumer, the woman that you have on paper, this strong, brave, courageous woman who doesn't take shit, the media would hate her too. You know what I mean? They wouldn't love her. Amy Schumer is not this person. Amy Schumer is just, look at her, stuck in this role. I don't believe a word this woman says.
I'm still undecided. Hillary! Vote for Hillary. Don't be crazy.
Even when she says, Hillary, it's like, that's not you. You're like, they wrote this down on paper, you had a couple notes, and now you're just pushing through. Look at this.
I don't want that for you. I don't want that for you, baby. Who do you want to vote for? I'm still...
How do people buy into that, by the way? How do people buy into that? Like, fuck yeah, Amy, finally somebody says it. See, when you see Trump do it, and of course, yeah, this is what we liked about him at the beginning. When you see Trump do it, it does seem very natural. It seems like, yeah, that's exactly what he wanted to say. He couldn't help himself. That just slipped out. That's just what he wanted to say. When you see Amy Schumer say what's just on her mind, it seems like, no, that sounds like what you think is edgy to say. You know, doesn't sound like you're really just rolling with it. And what's that again?
Okay, so I guess I am actually here to tell you to vote. Or at least cover your own ass so that you don't seem like
cover
a steamy dog.
Cover your own
dog.
Ass. What a move. For you.
I don't want that for you, baby. Who do you want to vote for? I'm still undecided. Hillary! Oof. Vote for Hillary. Don't be crazy.
Also, that used to be a thing that was tacky or looked down upon. You weren't supposed to just demand and tell people who to vote for. So people have been bullied. And yeah, I do agree with what Anthony says about the polls, where he goes, why would you tell the truth in the polls when every celebrity and everybody you've ever thought knew what they were talking about is telling you you're Hitler, you're the worst, you're responsible for the destruction of everything. So yeah, why would anybody want to admit that they're voting for Trump unless you had nothing to lose? So there's Amy Schumer, her desperate plea. What a new angle. I don't know if that angle is going to work on anybody. Hey, if you don't vote, people are going to know about it. So yeah, it brings me back to, is that bad? People don't know, or people are going to know that I didn't vote. That's a new bad thing. Okay. Never knew about that. Social justice warriors love this bitch. You never say what's on your mind while under perfect lighting. Yes. Reading the chat right now. Dan Wolf says, do these comedians think we actually find the Trump jokes clever? It's almost insulting. It's almost like they pushed people like me. You know, if they were the better side, they would be the responsible side. You know, they would be the understanding side. They would be the side that comes out and says, hey, we know. We get it. We all hate all this stuff, you know, but, you know, we got to find a more professional solution. They wouldn't say the stuff that they're saying. Seth MacFarlane wouldn't be acting like, you know, he just learned about emotions and how to handle them. You know, these people's Twitters is just one after the other. They can't control themselves. So let's see. Here's another one. This is, you know, her good buddy, Lena Dunham, who used to be my favorite. I think I've made fun of Lena Dunham so much that it doesn't have any spark left in me to go after her. But she is, one of the worst looking people I think we've ever seen. And she must know. I always wonder, it's like, do you think you know that it doesn't look good? You're going out of your way to be gray. You're going out of your way to be gross. And she put out a music video. So we're going to be seeing a lot of people's attempts to get your vote for Hillary. And looks like Lena Dunham put out a music video. And I want to watch this. It looks like one of those 80 Bryant jams from SNL. So let me see if I could find this. Lena Dunham song about Hillary. Have you seen this yet? So let's watch it together. Let's see what she's done. It's a funny or die.
Come on, right?
Do you guys know Lena? How do you know Lena?
She contacted my agent and said she was looking for friends.
Wow. I don't even know what to call that. This is a weird one here. We have... Hold on, they have a little sketch in front of this Lena Dunham rap video. This is pro-Hillary rap video. I've never seen one like this before. Now, this looks odd. It's a guy-girl mixed, black as fuck, wearing maroon glasses, a maroon Children of the Corn hat, a black leather jacket. She's drinking... you know, champagne mixed with orange juice, a mimosa, and there's something off about her face. It's a very dark black woman. It almost looks like she's wearing a, I don't know, what do they call that guy? Slash? Who's that? A slash wig? You know, a Halloween wig, a Howard Stern Halloween wig. And very black, but she doesn't look black. She almost looks like... a white person with black, painted black face. So this is a very odd, odd thing to look at. And, of course, she's very, very interested in all these things, you know, about saving people's life. Again, it's so funny that all these people so desperately, they care about people so much as to change the way we say things. You know, you can't say that's gay anymore because it's going to hurt a gay person's feelings. And what's so odd to me about that is, like, if you did care that much where you're worried about, you know, how somebody says something, you would also care, like, about being overweight. You know what I mean? Like, that would be your main concern. If you were so concerned with all this social justice stuff, wouldn't health come before that? So, like, before you're a social justice warrior, wouldn't you be like a health warrior? Because that's problem number one, right? Don't you want everyone to be healthy? You know, before their feelings, you would think health. But they have no concern about health. In fact, most social justice warriors are morbidly obese. And they not just fat. They don't have a nice-looking fat where you go, you know what? I could see how that could be a hot chick. She's still very tan and they're very pale. They're sick. They're heavy. And here is one of them. Look at this woman. Look at her. Leather jacket, maroon Mordecai hat, maroon glasses, and they love her. They would rather hang out with her than the greatest guy on earth. Because they see this and they go, that is a wonderful lady. Can we find her name and her Twitter and all that? I want to do a whole thing about her, whoever this person is. Because she's fucking sick. All right, let's back this up. This is Lena Dunham's new music video.
To brunch.
To brunch at Lena's.
Do you guys know Lena? How do you know Lena?
It's gay.
She contacted my agent and said she was looking
for friends.
Oh, you
have an agent?
Yeah. I hope to write
down. Oh, and what do you do? What do you do? You have an agent. She contacted your agent. What possibly could you do that needs representation? You're giving things to the public? You're working as an entertainer? Where?
Looking for friends.
Yeah. I hope to write down or record her saying something controversial what? Today and sell that to the media.
God.
Be part of her undoing and monetarily gain from that.
Hi. I'm sorry about that. My periods are
Here's Lena.
Insane. It's so amazing to have my closest friends here at brunch. But as you know, with me, nothing is ever as it seems. So this is not like a simple brunch. I have been so shaken by this election. It has unveiled the darkest aspects of American culture, and the racist, homophobic, ableist, and xenophobic rhetoric is making me ill. So what do you think I'm going to do?
I do not know what xenophobic means. Never learned it, never bothered. Xenophobic. Could you am I xenophobic? Press one in the chat if I am xenophobic. But don't tell me what it means.
Do with all this energy and all this rage.
I mean, use your writing.
Volunteer.
Use television. You have a television show.
That's all a little bit basic. What I ultimately decided on was that the medium for me to express my anger was rapt music.
Very funny. Rapt music. You hear her?
No.
She's funny.
Absolutely. Lena, no. Lena Dunham.
Hey, hey, guys. It's MC Pantsuit. My hobby is rap music, but my passion? Defending the nation's baddest grandmother. I'm talking Hillary Rodham Clinton.
And it's almost like, you ever remember when your parents or your family got the first video camera? And you just wanted to play with it. Because it wasn't about content. You and your little brother didn't sit around writing out things that you wanted to film. You just wanted to film yourselves. I'm xenophobic, they're saying. You are, Mike. They're all saying I'm xenophobic. Okay, so what is a xenophobe? Let me know in the chat. But it's almost like Lena Dunham and Amy Schumer. You know, Amy Schumer did this with the Beyonce video last week. To them, it's just, if you film it and you're doing it, it's funny. If you film it and you're doing it, ha ha. But not to us. Like, it needs to have a point now. Any YouTuber could film themselves doing a rap parody. That doesn't really mean much anymore. So to just, you know, SNL does this all the time where they think, hey, if we film it and we make it kind of look like a rap video and then do what the opposite of a rapper would be, it'll be funny. But that's not enough anymore. You got to kind of have a point. So she's, oh, hi, I'm MC Pantsuit. And that's supposed to be funny because most MCs, they don't wear pantsuits, you see. And they usually say it in a blacker voice. This is very funny. This is very similar to Amy Schumer's formation thing, where the idea is not thought out.
Oh, yeah. Lena Dunham.
This is my first time watching the full thing.
Hey, hey, guys, it's MC Pantsuit. My hobby is rap music, passion.
Xenophobic people don't like people outside of their race or culture. Okay. Well, then I'm not xenophobic, but I'm very close to it. I favor them less. I would much rather, you know, every reality show proves it. I would much rather date a white than, let's say, an Indian. I can't even imagine kissing an Indian woman. I was watching The Bachelor Canada last week with my wife where the girl, she has chosen this Indian guy. A white, happy girl has chosen this Indian guy. They're kissing, and you're going, isn't that smell or something? You know, it just looks... And it doesn't mean that I hate Indians. It just means, I don't know, you know? Little too brown.
Defending the nation's baddest grandmother. I'm talking Hillary Rodham Clinton. I get upset when people say that Hillary needs to smile. She's the strongest fucking person. Couldn't even walk a mile.
Oh, shit. Charlamagne the God's in there. The God. What did she say? So she's the strongest fucking person.
The heels of this woman had to fight her whole life, defending everything she does to the left and to the right. She's been a lawyer, first lady, senator, plus a mom. Fights for justice since the age of 15.
You know, Louis C.K. said this the other day. She's a mom. What kind of mom? She had a pregnancy, yes. Hillary Clinton is not a mom. Hillary Clinton got pregnant and had a child. Yes. But a mom takes a little bit more than doing all this. I've never seen Hillary doing anything motherly. She's running around. She's got papers. She's got handlers. She's smiling. There's no mom stuff going on. And to be a mom does not impress me. Okay? Hillary Clinton is a mom. That is wonderful. That is something almost every human being on the earth is capable of being, except for men, of course, but you get my point. That shouldn't be like, she's a mom, she's great. Louis C.K. has lost his mind. Gavin, listen to yesterday's Gavin. He really, really, really hit the nail on the head with Louis C.K. He was saying, it's because he's a businessman. Louis C.K. positions himself. Louis C.K. took himself off Twitter. Let me tell you why Louis C.K. took himself off Twitter. See, he's a liar. Louis C.K., to me, looks like a man waiting for this whole thing to crumble. He used to be so cool. Remember that Patrice O'Neill nigger thing that he did? Patrice O'Neill on Opie and Anthony? Cumia! Patrice O'Neill on Opie and Anthony was like, you know where the word dyke came from? It was because, you know, and then he gave some explanation. He was being serious. Patrice O'Neill, not that, by the way. And then Louis came on and he goes, do you know where the word nigger came from, actually? And they were like, oh, no. You know, where did it originate? He goes, this guy was walking around and he's being a real nigger. And everyone burst out laughing. It was one of the better moments. I remember that was like a real standout moment. I go, wow. See, it really doesn't matter. It's all about the absurdity. The big laugh is about the absurdity. And Louis C.K. was like the nigger guy. He was funny. He was down to earth. And we all fell in love with Louis C.K. because it was like, oh yeah, he could say the most awful stuff ever, but we know that it's not coming from any place of hatred. It's coming from a place of absurdity. And so you respected him for that. You're like, yeah, that's what we want. We need guys like that showing the world there's nothing to be offended by. There's nothing to be mad about. This is silliness. And now Louis turned into the complete opposite of that. And he's telling people, oh, Hillary is a great mother. You got to go vote for it. It was really, really bad. Called me an asshole for not voting. Called Trump Hitler. And, you know, the other day he was backpedaling. See, people are starting to backpedal now. Now, people have lightened up on Trump this week, I think. I think they know something might come and they're really facing reality and they've lightened up a little bit. Louis C.K. wrote a thing about Trump being Hitler, didn't he? A while back. And now, if you watch that clip the other day where he was on Fallon or whatever saying that we need to elect Hillary, he was going, hey, listen, if you want to vote for Trump, that's fine. Listen, I'm not against you. Really? You're not against people that vote for Hitler? But you said he's Hitler. If these people actually believe that Trump was Hitler, wouldn't they do whatever it takes to stop these people from voting? They wouldn't say stuff like, well, I don't, you know, if you're going to vote for Trump, that's fine. Is it fine? You called him Hitler. And now you're kind of backpedaling, aren't you? You know, because I think it's getting a little real here. And these people are realizing that they're going to, you know, lose a lot of their people. All right, let's go back to the Lena Dunham last attempt to get Hillary elected. This is her rap music video.
Defending the nation's baddest grandmother, I'm talking Hillary Rodham Clinton. I get upset when people say that Hillary needs to smile. She's the strongest fucking person, couldn't even walk a mile. In the heels of this woman, had to fight her whole life, defending everything she does to the left and to the right. Woo! She's been a lawyer, first lady, senator, plus a mom. Fights for justice since the age of 15.
Man, come on.
And she did it in a man's world.
Not a joke.
By the way, saying man, come on, that's not a joke. Why did they blow the air horn? They literally like dropped the beat and blew an air horn because they went, man, come on. I know that was like one of your first rap rhymes, and when you laid that down, you're like, yeah, man, come on. It rhymed with mom. Wait, what did she rhyme that with? Because they got really excited about that. It's not a punchline. This is one of the best writers. This is a Emmy-nominated girls writer. Man, come on. Listen.
For justice since the age of 15.
Man, come on.
Wait, I want to see what that rhymed with, though.
All in the heels of this woman had to fight her whole life. Right. Defending everything she does to the left and to the right. She's been a lawyer, first lady, senator, plus a mom. Fights for justice since the age of 15.
Man, come on.
And she...
Why the celebration? Why the air horn? Man, come on. Fuck yeah, killed it. Not really. Mom and man, come on. It's not really that great of a rhyme.
Did it in a man's world, shatters last feeling still. All these little bitches will assume she catching feelings. Fuck that, my girl's a rider, progressive freedom fighter. Going up against a dude who's a climate change denier. She worked harder than her man did, still saw her grandkid. And people have the nerve to ask her what her plan is. The plan is to...
People have the nerve to ask her what her plan is. That really came out of a person's mouth. This was reviewed, this was edited, this was gone over, people went over this thing. Listen to this.
Going up against a dude who's a climate change denier. She worked harder than her man London still saw her grandkid, and people have the nerve to ask her what her plan is.
Yeah, we have the nerve. People have the nerve to ask her what her plan. This is what happens when you get addicted to a team. You do whatever it takes. You start ignoring reality. It was when they turned Trump, when they turned that speech, when he said illegal immigrants are rapists, and they turned it into, he just said immigrants are all rapists. It's from that point on where you really just lost all aspects of reality.
Plan is to win against hatred and slurs.
Her plan is to win against hatred and slurs. Really? Is that the biggest problem America's facing? I didn't realize. Her plan is to win against hatred and slurs. See, this is why I can't have her win. I do a show with hatred and slurs. I cannot have her defeat that. I don't feel comfortable with that. Trump in office, believe me, here's really my line of thinking. If somebody sent Trump a tape of Redbar and they were trying to, you know, indict me or have me arrested for hate speech, I feel like Trump would listen and go, no, the guy's just joking around. But I feel like if Hillary listened, she would also know I was joking around, but be like, he must face the death penalty. That's how I feel. I feel like Hillary Clinton is the Cameron Esposito of the world, trying to abolish people like me. But not really Hillary. I feel like Hillary doesn't care about that. She's kind of just latched on to that idea to appease these psychos. Because she wants these psychos on her side. These are her, what would you call? Minions. Yeah, these are the people that work for her. She needs these crazy women. So let's hear that. She's going to abolish me, huh?
For what her plan is. The plan is to win against hatred and slurs. Break it down in three words. I'm with her.
I can't believe she's in the race with this guy. Let's get out and vote her.
The writing. It's like the left. This is the problem. I'm not a policy guy. I'm commenting on this as, what's going on? They've lost creativity. You've got all these writers, all these people. This is all they have to say. He's a clown. I'm with her. It's not, it doesn't have the same punch. You know, these are our highest paid people on the job coming up with stuff to say. And this is what they've got to, you know, you go to, again, you go to Seth MacFarlane's Twitter. Can't believe Trump thinks, what a clown. What a tool bag. It's like their emotions have crushed their ability to be creative anymore. That's the oddest part of this whole thing to me.
Everybody might die.
Everybody might die? This is straight up propaganda. Everybody might die.
I can't believe she's in the race with this guy.
Die.
Vote.
Everybody might die. Guys, come on. How is this acceptable? That's nuts. These are little kids watching this. Let's get out and vote, or everybody might die. That's fucking crazy. Yeah, that's fucking, I've never heard of anything like that.
And if the plan is to win against hatred and slurs, break it down in three words. I'm with her.
I can't believe she's in the race with this guy. Let's get her out the door, or everybody might die.
That's irresponsible a little bit. Everybody might die. Okay. How? Why would everybody die?
Mary J. Blige, I believe.
Ain't nothing new, motherfucker. She's Hillary.
She's Hillary. And now I'm gonna take off my pantsuit to reveal a more sensual pantsuit, because that's what you do for the candidate you love.
Not really sure I understand the logic.
Charlamagne the God.
And why are you wearing Hillary's lingerie?
You've gotta show your whole body, everything that you have, for the candidate you love.
I'm not sure how appropriating Iggy Azalea's culture is gonna help Hillary win, though.
Dance with me, Cynthia. Take your pantsuit off and show us your sensual pantsuit, Cynthia. No, I'm good.
Cynthia? Wait, that's not Mary J. Blige? She keeps calling her Cynthia. I swore, I thought for sure that was Mary J. Blige. Who's Cynthia?
And show us your sensual pantsuit, Cynthia. No, I'm
good. I wonder if I'm actually...
It's not even good singing.
Don't forget to vote November 8th.
My girl's a rider.
Don't forget, guys. Jesus Christ. So, this is going to be fun. We've got Cumia going live election night. I believe we'll be here too. We want you to open both screens. We want you to open both screens. But election night is going to fucking rule. Like I said, you know, we don't cover all this on the show. We're not one of these day-to-day Steven Crowder type of shows. Dear God. Guys, you know, this is my problem. It's like, I know you want Trump to win, and I know you feel personally offended by the Sarah Silvermans and all these people who are telling you your shit, but Steven Crowder is not the solution, okay? Going to this opposite side where it's me versus him, you know, Steven Crowder presents his argument with this smirk. That's not the answer, you know? It's not to be a grosser piece of shit, because listen, they think you're just as gross as you think they are. That's what's really going on. You don't want to be gross. You don't want to be a piece of shit. And, you know, you don't want to do whatever it takes. I'm telling you, Mike, it's Cynthia Erivo. Who the fuck is Cynthia Erivo? Did you fuck her? The body was the closest thing to a joke in the whole thing. Cynthia is a British actress who recently won a Tony for The Color Purple. I thought that was Lee from American Horror Story, Roanoke Nightmare. Mike loves Crowder. No, I actually don't like Crowder. I find him to be a little vindictive, puffy, muscled, fat show. No, I'm just kidding. I like Steven Crowder. I like Steven Crowder. I think he's good. But I mean, 1 million views. All he's doing is making... And then all of a sudden, like a picture of E.T. comes in. Hillary Clinton and Podesta on the email links. And then it's E.T. phone home. WikiLeaks founder Huma... I don't even know. but I'm telling you, Steven Crowder, he's not your guy. It's Harambe's sister. Crowder does that YouTuber thing, acting like a kid for the likes, but it doesn't make sense because he's not a kid show. Yeah. Why can't he just be honest? No, I guess people need things in hot sauce packet-sized morsels, but sometimes his little... swishes go on for too long, like it'll go whoosh, and then it's like 10 minutes of a scene from Star Wars and you're going, I get the joke. I kind of get the joke on minute one. Kind of speed it up. Yeah. She got that Kathy Bates body. Are you guys watching American Horror Story? My Roanoke Nightmare? A lot of people getting killed on that show. Have you seen Lee? Oh, I said I had a gift for the Proud Boys. Proud Boys, you out there? Proud Boys, I want to show you how serious I am about being a, what I like to consider myself, a ninth degree Proud Boy. So, I've set up a live feed. All right, I need everyone to pay attention. If you're a Proud Boy especially, Uhuru! I've set up a live feed outside, and I want to show you how legit I am. I know you guys are kind of on the fence about Gavin because he says that, you know, mixed couples are fine.
You know, not me. I am very anti a certain group of people, and I just want to show you what I've done. I've gone ahead and done something here. Okay, hold on. Let me find this. I got to find the feed here. Give me a second here. Give me 1 second. I'm going to show you guys what I've done to a gift for the Proud Boys here. Okay. So I guess I'll just show you the live feed. Let's cut to the live feed. This is a gift for the Proud Boys here. We're live. This is a live YouTube feed. Right here. I'm going to let you guys watch this for a second. This is a gift to you, Proud Boys. Uhuru! So, you guys are probably watching now. And what you're seeing, this is perfect. Cameron Malik, our web developer, is on scene right now. He's the person videotaping this. Okay, we are live right now in the suburbs of Chicago, where I got word that a Jew and a black person have an interracial marriage. Ladies and gentlemen, for the Proud Boys, I have gone ahead. We burned down their house. We've set their house afire to show you that we mean business. This is a mixed race couple's house. It is burning down in front of your very eyes. We are here with you, Proud Boys. We unite with you. We believe in your cause. Let's watch the house burn. This is a mixed race couple's house. I followed them home the other night, and I hired somebody to set fire to their house. So, for anybody on the fence about how down I am for those Proud Boys, here it is. 6 people have died, including a child. Uhuru! We'll, bye-bye, you fucks. Burn them. They're all yelling, yes. This shit is fire. Live feed. A bomb blew up right up there on the roof where they were all sleeping. Just a mixed-race couple. There we go. So we'll check back on that in a little bit, and see how the family's doing. But believe me, I already have a text with a message saying that they are badly, badly dead and in the hospital. Redbar has killed many folks. Let them know what happens when you mix. Yes, exactly. Shout-outs to the Proud Boys. Uhuru! Yeah, reading the chat right now. Right, what race is Gavin's wife? We don't talk about other people's wives here. Where is the Shekla? I've got the Sheckler here, but every time I play the Sheckler, we have a problem. Sheckler coming up on the after show today. So this is what we're going to do, since Redbar is a show that goes already. So here's how we're going to have it. We're going to have Redbar as a free show is going to be randomly throughout the week at redbarradio.net. The Cumia exclusive show will be every Friday at 4 p.m. Eastern on compoundmedia.com. And then following the Cumia show, we'll have an after show for our Barmy members, our bonus content club, and that will be at redbarradio.net as well. So after this, we will show you the Sheckler and all that stuff. Baby dead, ha-ha. Redbar killed them. They fell asleep smoking. Wait for the ha-has. Barrier boy, you sure do talk about wives. We don't. So there, I hope the Proud Boys now understand that I am legit as fuck and I'm here for their cause. Me and Emily Yukis are great friends. I'm kidding. That girl is a She's not a 6. She's not an 8.4. Emily Yukis is a 1. Look her up. Almost a 0. Gavin is a great man, though, and I would never talk shit about a great man's woman, even if she's not white. Of course. Why would you? And I believe we're going to get a picture. I've got Cameron Malik, our web developer, is on the scene there with the, doing the camera work. You know, pretending that he's reporting for the school paper. He's out there by the fire, and he's going to be sending me pictures of the victims once he gets over to the hospital. So, uhuru, everybody. It's my gift to the Proud Boys. Anything you guys need, any people you need dead, we will show you how that all works. What time is it here? 1:49. Oh my God, we only have 10 minutes of the show left. So we are doing an after show. We are going to have a celebration show where we all drink and smoke weed. So hang out with us after this at redbarradio.net. We'll probably be going all night. We'll probably be going, till about 2, 3 in the morning here today. So the show is just getting started. Somebody says, ha-ha, Yukis. Nothing to be sad about Bill Burr's wife. Don't know why you're even... Guys, I'm going to try to get Bill Burr's wife on the show. I'm addicted to this thing. Bill Burr thinks that all of a sudden he could... Somebody send me a picture of Bill Burr's wife. Post it in the chat so people could see. Cameron risked his life for the... No, they don't know. Cameron's not involved. Cameron didn't set the fire. Cameron is just there filming. They're saying Cameron risked his life for the bar. Uhuru, I have enjoyed the show and show 00, and we'll be looking forward to it on Fridays. Great. Thank you. Mike Fenoya's old spot. Cameron has files on us all. Yeah, Cameron is our web developer. You'll meet him, and you'll meet all the people in the show. You'll meet all the inside jokes. You'll understand what this thing's all about. That's why I change usernames so often. Great show. If you stay, if you stream, I'll be there. Uh-oh. So can we watch for free tonight? Yes, everybody is welcome. As soon as this show ends in 10 minutes, you're welcome to go to redbarradio.tv or redbarradio.net and click on the live button there. And come over. We're going to be hanging out all night. We're going to be getting on Skype. We're going to be drinking. And we're going to be having a little bit of fun to celebrate our big Cumia announcement. So 1 to 2 a.m. Yeah, maybe even later. It's Friday. This is what we do. We usually do this every Friday over here. Burr's wife is just a regular woman. Okay. Bill Burr's wife. Oh, shit. So I asked for links of Bill Burr's wife. That is obviously just a stock image of Garinzo. Gorilla in its natural habitat. Not Bill Burr's wife. Let's see what this is. Of course, every link says Harambe. I asked for a picture of Bill Burr's wife, the sweet woman, so I could show you just who she is. Harambe, of course. Is that Harambe himself? I thought his name was Harambol for the first month. That's how not interested I was about that. So, let's see. Oh, another picture. Oh, here's Bill Burr and his wife. Okay, sure. AMC's, what was his name? Colin Huel. Huel from Breaking Bad. Very, very funny. Bill Burr and his wife. Here, maybe that's how he met his wife, through Huel. Let's see. Sweet, looking forward to the after show. Yeah, you're all welcome. We're going to hang out. We're going to drink in just a few minutes. We want Proud Boys, they're saying. Okay. You got them. So I hope the Proud Boys accept me. I hope the rest of you accept me. We're going to have a great time here. We're really going to have a great time. This show finds itself in its own situations. So, you know, just from the things we say on the show, we end up finding ourselves in trouble, which lead to a lot of fun show content. So I hope that you're excited to be here with us. Wait, wait, wait. Is this Bill Burr and his wife? Finally, thank you very much. A normal picture of Bill Burr and his wife. Here she is. Now, what's wrong with that? So people have a problem? What's wrong with that? A lot of things. It's very startling. All of a sudden, Bill Burr, who we thought was just a regular guy,
all of a sudden, hi, I'd like you to meet my wife. And you're like,
practical joke?
You whisper in his ear. Imagine if you were Bill Burr's friend. You had no idea this relationship was going on. Oh, yeah, I never introduced you to my wife. Let me show you. And you go, oh, yeah, great. Yeah, let's meet for dinner. And then he shows up with this and you go,
that's kind of a, is that a joke?
You'd be shocked. And he never brings it up. We've heard her on the podcast. I thought she was just like a, I imagine, because I listen to Bill Burr's Monday morning podcast. I love Bill Burr. But you hear his wife coming on the podcast, and I always envisioned her as like Hillary from Fresh Prince. You know, like a half black, half white woman with like hip, curly hair and big hoop earrings. And she was like New York fresh, you know, one of those hip, youthful, smiley. She looks like a, you know, a black lady in a commercial. But then he appears with this, and this is like a 76-year-old, old, yeah, Bill Burr's wife was great in Family Matters, they're saying. Yeah. Carol! Imagine her, yeah, holding that basket of laundry. Official Redbar Facebook group, yeah. Okay, so we're going to end here today. Thank you guys for being a part of show number one. Hey, let me tell you something. This wasn't the show that I wanted it to be, of course. You know, everybody picked up on that. I'm sure many of you are making fun of me. I don't care. I'm going to be above that because all of you, you know, would do much worse. So, you know, I know that it will turn into the funnest of times. I hope you still had, you know, a semi-good time here. We have many chances to make it up to you. This after show is a hell of a place to start. We're going to be drinking. We're going to be smoking. We're going to be doing whatever we want. We do have a special guest coming up on the after show. So come hang out. The chat is still open. We'll be here at redbarradio.net in just a few minutes. And we'll see you every Friday at 4 p.m. Eastern on compoundmedia.com. And thanks for everybody who supported this, who made this move possible. All these people retweeting, all these people saying, get Redbar on Cumia over this last year, you know, ever since I filled in for Gavin. So all of that, you know, tremendous thank you. Thank you to Keith the Cop. Thank you to Anthony Cumia. My king! No thanks to Opie. No, thank you to Opie. He made this possible. If Opie was still around, this wouldn't have been possible. So thank you, Opie. Thank you, Kim. Thank you, Kanye. All right, we'll see you guys next week, and we'll see you on the after show, and we'll probably have a bunch of shows in between. I want to merge all the universes. So I want everybody to watch Fridays at 4 p.m. Eastern on Compound, randomly throughout the week at redbarradio.net, and then the after shows as well. We'll try to merge it. It's a little tricky since we're a show that's been around already, and we're still trying to figure it all out. But hopefully it goes well. It's been a hell of a week. We're going to have a lot of fun times on this show. We always do. All right, we'll be right back with an after. Shout outs. Thanks for coming out, guys. We'll see you later. In just a second. Don't even touch. It's going to be like a one song break so I could go pee. And we'll be right back. Shout outs!
Hey, y'all heard about the good news? Y'all sleeping on me, huh? Had a good snooze.
Wake up, niggas, wake up.
We about to get this paper. Money never made me. Made me do something, nah, can't make me. Even if the money low can't pay me. Even if the money low can't play me. Hey, y'all heard about the good news? Y'all sleeping on me, huh? Had a good snooze. Wake up, nigga, wake up. We about to get this paper. Pablo bought a Rolly and a Rottweiler. Seemed like the more fame I only got wilder. Hands up, we just doing what the cops taught us. Hands up, we just doing what the cops taught us. I've been out of my mind.
And if you're listening live, join our chat, redbarradio.net/chat. redbarradio.net/chat. We want you in.
Y'all heard about the good news?
After.
Y'all sleeping on me, huh? Had a good snooze. Wake up, nigga, wake up.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I gotta cut this feed. So I'm going to cut this feed right now, and we'll be at redbarradio.net/ or redbarradio.tv, okay? We'll see you soon.
I'm a Chicago, South Side. I'm a Chicago, South Side. Hey, y'all heard about the good news? Y'all sleeping on your boy, had a good snooze. Wake up, nigga, wake up. It's time to get the paper. I've been out of my mind
a long time.
I've been out of my mind a long time. I know, I shouldn't even bother with all these gossiping. No pussy getting bloggers. Fashion showing Gotham. I need another costume. Peter mad cause I made a jacket out of possum. Awesome. Steve Jobs mixed with Steve Austin. Rich slave in the fabric store picking cotton. If Hov Jaden, every Jordan need a Rodman. Man, Jaden don't really want no problems. Driving in the same car that they kill pocket. Driving in the same that they kill pocket. Hands up, we just doing what the cops taught us. Hands up, then the cops shot us.
Hold on. Wait a second. Everybody here, I'm the ghetto Oprah. You know what that mean? You get a fur. You get a fur. You get a jet. Big booty bitch for you.
All right, I'm cutting the feed, and we'll see you on redbarradio.tv.